Good morning, Saints of First Church.
Good morning.
It is a joy to see you in God's house on this beautiful Sunday morning. We're glad all of you are here this morning, especially those who may be visiting with us. We ask all of you, whether you're a first-time visitor, a long-time member, or somewhere in between, if you'll sign the registration pad at the end of your row, we might have a record of your attendance with us on this Lord's Day. We'd appreciate it. We're thrilled that you're with us. Let me share with you some announcements. You'll find those on the opportunities page in your bulletin, and we encourage you to take a look at those at your leisure. First of all, I want to call your attention to an insert you have in your bulletin, and this is an opportunity for you to honor your mother and father. There'll be an insert on Mother's Day, May the 13th, and on Father's Day, June 17th, with those names, and you can fill out the form and submit $1 per entry on the form there. We'll make sure that takes place. Understand, this is the only form that's going to be distributed, and the deadline is April 23rd. So please remember that. That'll be in a couple of weeks. So you need to go ahead, and if you're going to do that as quickly as you can. And remember that both mothers and fathers are to go on that on the form. Let me give you a couple other announcements. Wednesday night supper is back, and all of God's people said, yum, yum. We'll have another good time of food and fellowship. We encourage you to come out and be a part of that. Want to alert you to an opportunity we're going to have at the end of this month. On the 29th, there will be one service here in the sanctuary as we celebrate our heritage and remember the 100th anniversary of our educational building. Isn't that interesting that in 1918, First Church had outgrown the place where God's people were nurtured into faith and said, we need some more room. And so in faith, they stepped out and built the building that we have the opportunity to use this day, and we're very grateful for that. So plan on coming out at 10 o'clock on the 29th. We'll have a good time of worship and fellowship together, and then we will engage in that United Methodist sacrament known as the covered dish meal. We hope you'll come out and be a part of that good time of food and fellowship with us. Also, remember that the annual yard sale is coming up. Our missions committee is already beginning to collect some things. If you have something you'd like to drop off, there is a possibility of doing that, and you have the contact information that you need for that. Now, Ms. Shirley, you have an announcement, I believe. And Drew, can you, Ms. Shirley, use that microphone?
Good morning. The United Methodist Women's Circle of Mary and Martha has planned an event, and it's going to be the Home and Garden Show for First United Methodist Church, and it will be on Saturday, April the 28th from 10 until 2 in Wesley Hall. We have speakers lined up who are coming to do demonstrations on planting a pot garden. We have an interior designer coming to speak with us, and we'll have a demonstration on flower arranging and how to do a tablescape with items that you can buy at the dollar store. The ticket includes a box lunch. We'll have a lovely box lunch. Tickets are $20, and all of the proceeds go to the missions of the church through the Circle of Mary and Martha. Tickets are limited, and so myself and one other lady will be out selling tickets outside if you'd like to go ahead and get your ticket today. One other thing that I forgot to mention is we have commissioned a local artist who is making a lovely sterling silver and Swarovski crystal cross. These will be in a limited edition, but you can place orders for those on that day. You will be able to see all of the choices that you can make. You can customize it to the size you want and the color of the crystals that you'd like for it to be in there. And all the proceeds for that goes to our missions, too. So we hope you'll buy a ticket and come and join us and have a good day. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Shirley. And we hope you all will come out and be a part of the garden show by the Circle of Mary and Martha. We appreciate that. Are there other announcements that need to be made? If not, it is a joy to see you in God's house. Let us prepare our hearts and minds now for worship.
Thank you.
invite you now to stand as you're able as we join together in our call to worship printed in your bulletins. Let us worship the Lord and receive the anointing of God's blessing.
How good and pleasant it is when we live together in unity. Praise the Lord.
Let's join now together in the opening prayer. God of many blessings, make us mindful of your presence with us this day. We come to you to know peace, to rediscover joy, to believe where we have not seen. We have come to touch the glory of everlasting life made possible through Jesus Christ. Give us grace to be open to the fullness of your invitation to know what it means to truly live. Through Jesus Christ our Lord we pray. Amen. Our opening hymn is number 307 in your hymnals, Christ is Risen. Psalter for this morning is Psalm 133. It's on page 850 in the back of your hymnals. Psalm 133. And let us read together responsively. Behold, how good and pleasant it is when we live together in unity.
It is like the precious oil upon the head, running down upon the beard, upon the beard of Aaron, running down on the collar of his robe.
It is like the dew of Hermon, which falls on the mountains of Zion.
For there the Lord has commanded the blessing, life forevermore.
People gather together in God's house, let us turn and exchange signs of his love and peace with one another.
Thank you. disciples to come up. So if I can have any young ones up here with me and join me on this step here so we don't bother the Lord's table.
There you go.
How's everybody doing today? Good? All right. Well, I thought we could play a little game today to start us off. And it's called Two Truths and a Lie. So I'm going to say three statements about myself. Two of them are true. One of them is not. And I want you three to figure out which one is a lie. All right, here we go. I've been published 10 times. I rode a roller coaster with the entire band Skillet. And I climbed three mountains, one volcano, and I biked on a glacier. The last one, I think the mountains, volcano, and glacier is false. What about you, Michael?
That's what I think, too.
So, I have been published several times. Once for short fiction, six times in poetry, and three of my photographs have been in books. I have climbed three mountains, two in Haiti, one in the Smoky Mountains. I climbed a volcano in Italy, Mount Vesuvius. And I biked on a glacier in Alaska. I, however, have not ridden on a roller coaster with the entire band Skillet. But their lead singer was on the roller coaster with me. We were wearing the same hoodie and we became friends. So sometimes we hear things that are a little unbelievable, right? What do we do in that moment? Do we just not question it and think, okay, it must be true? Or do we say, I need some more proof to find out if that's true or not? So, do we need more proof sometimes? Yeah? All right. Well, back in the Bible days, back after Jesus had died on the cross and after he came back, he revealed himself to several of his disciples, all but one. His name is Thomas. Now Thomas, he doubted that Jesus came back, and he needed more proof that Jesus was back. So he needed to feel the wounds that were given to him on the cross, to make sure that it was dead. Sometimes we need more proof in order for us to believe the unbelievable. And once we have that proof, we can go out and share the unbelievable with others in a way that they can start believing as well. So, I hope that we can be like Thomas, and if we doubt, we find the right proof, go out and let everybody else know the unbelievable. How's that sound? Okay. Got the thumbs up. Let us pray. Dear God.
Dear God.
We love you so much.
We love you so much.
You came.
You came.
You died.
You died.
You came back.
You came back.
And you will come back again.
And you will come back again.
All for us.
All for us.
And so we may love you.
So we may love you.
Help us.
Help us.
When we hear things.
When we hear things.
That are unbelievable.
That are unbelievable.
Help us.
Help us.
Know that things are true.
Know that things are true.
When sometimes.
When sometimes.
They're hard to know they are true.
They're hard to know they are true.
Help us go into the world.
Help us go into the world
and share the news.
And share the news
that you came back.
That you came back
and are coming again.
And are coming again.
In your name we pray.
In your name we pray.
Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
This is the opportunity that we have as a church family to come to the Lord with our prayers of praise and also our prayers of concern. I will take the first praise or prayer concern now. For Dan Addis, we will continue to pray around that situation. The choir is pleased to have Bill and Judy back. And a lot of prayers lifted there. Yes, Barbara. Family of David Rouse. Yes. You're asking me a question. Did Renee get home? My understanding is the answer is yes. Susie and I have not seen her yet. But Renee Douglas was due to be home this weekend, and that's a wonderful thing. She's been on a long journey and will continue to be on that journey. Okay. At this time, let's enter a time of silent prayer. I will lift a pastoral prayer and we will move forward with our service. God, hear our prayers. Lord, there is no doubt that you are a good God and that you love us. And we thank you and we praise you today. We thank you for the sunrise. We thank you for the leaves and the flowers bursting with life and the birds and wildlife that are coming around. And there is just no denying the fact that you have created beauty and that it is all around us. That enough, God, is enough to cause us to sing your praises and to lift up joy, knowing that you're on our side. And as your word says, if you are for us, who can be against us? In this time, we remember those prayers that have been lifted verbally and those that are close to our hearts and are on our minds that have been silent today, knowing that you're a God who doesn't experience any mystery at all. You know everything. You have us from behind. You walk alongside of us, and you know the future because you're already there. You are amazing. You overcame the grave. You sent your Son into the world to allow us a way of redeeming with you the things that have been lost because of human sin. Thank you for your relentless love for us and your pursuit of us, your prevenient grace that draws us to Christ, your justifying grace that allows us to be forgiven of our sins through his blood, and your sanctifying grace that allows us to be discipled and to be made more and more into your image. We ask God for your mercy for those who are sick and hurting, for those who live in war-torn parts of the world, for those who live in anxiety and worry and doubt. God, we cry out to you on behalf of the ones who have no voice, on behalf of the persecuted church, on behalf of those people who suffer in silence because they love you and they want to talk about that. Help us to use our platform of worship today to shine a light on your goodness, that there would be no doubt that you are the God of all creation, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of Jesus Christ, who lives inside of us and fills us with the Spirit even now. In your name I pray, amen.
Thank you.
At this time, would the ushers please come forward so we prepare to give our tithes and our offerings.
You may be seated.
Thank you.
I had to get exercise in between services, so I was doing that. It's good to see you this morning. It's good to be seen. You may remember last week. I hope you remember last week. Okay, we don't have to get it. There we go. We were having a big time, and a big crowd, and a big celebration. You remember, some of us are young enough to remember a fellow by the name of Paul Harden. You know, Paul was famous for giving you the rest of the story. Exactly right. We're going to do that today. Now, I told you last week, I got so excited at 8:30 that I blew right past what I was supposed to read, had hit brakes. I want to back up and give you one verse from last week and go into this week, because I think it's important. We're going to talk about it in a minute. If you have your Bibles with you, or a few Bibles that are in front of you, we're going to look in the 20th chapter of John's Gospel, John 20. We're going to begin looking at verse 18. And then we're going to read all the way through verse 29. We're going to try to unpack a lot today, so we're going to be stepping high and fast. We're going to get good, important stuff, so hope you will bear with me as we go forward. Let's hear God's word together. Beginning verse 18. Mary Magdalene went and said to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being shut where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I send you." And when he had said this, he breathed. Everybody take a deep breath. Breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. And if you retain the sins of any, they are retained." Now, Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see in his hands the print of the nails, and place my finger in the mark of the nails, and place my hand in his side, I will not believe." 8 days later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. The doors were shut, but Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not be faithless, but believe it." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen me and yet believe." Beloved, this is the word of God for the people of God and the house of God.
Thanks be to God.
And let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for a beautiful day in which we can come to worship you and break once more together the bread of life. We pray, God, that you would allow it in this time together to fill us to overflowing so that when we leave this place, we will do so with a message to proclaim to our community and to the world itself. We pray this in your name and for your sake. Amen. Justin Brierley, in his book entitled Unbelievable, Why After 10 Years of Talking with Atheists, I'm Still a Christian. Now, how's that for a book title? He posed a really interesting question that a lot of people pose. He asked this question. He said, What if the disciples were merely hallucinating when they saw the resurrected Christ? Well, Justin then went into a series of studies that had been done by scientists and psychologists, and the studies showed that every once in a very great while, an individual might have a hallucination of a lost loved one. But as far as mass hallucination is concerned, those things do not happen. Brierley goes on to write that the scriptures tell us that 100% of the disciples claim to have had a visual encounter with the risen Christ. And to those who say, well, they must have had such a great psychological need for this that they conjured it up in their mind and imagined they saw it, this is what Brierley writes. He says, the disciples had no such expectations for a risen Messiah figure. The resurrection of Christ was completely unexpected and out of keeping with standard Jewish theological expectations. The scriptures are quite clear in telling us time and again about the skepticism of the disciples. Now that's good information for us to have this morning as we begin our study of our text. That's good information for us to understand. Because I find it really interesting, don't you, that we move from this celebration of unbridled joy that we had just last week to this moment in the text where the very people who should have been most enthused, most excited, most energized are in the exact opposite posture. They're cowering. They're fearful. They're hiding behind locked doors. That's strange, isn't it? It's interesting, I think, that we move from a celebration of certainty to an examination of the presence of doubt in the lives of all of the disciples. But we focus particularly this morning on the life of one, Thomas. Well, I want you to understand, I think, as we study this passage together, we're going to understand that there's more going on here than meets the eye. We're going to understand that doubt is something that can affect people across the entire spectrum. We're going to find out that Thomas, far from being the poster boy of skepticism, is actually, I think, a very powerful example of what a true believer and follower of Jesus is supposed to look like. As he shows us how to believe the unbelieving. Now, Thomas is only mentioned a very few times in scriptures. On one occasion that he's mentioned, he comes across looking like a very courageous and faith-filled individual. If you remember in John 11, Jesus is preparing to go to the home of Mary and Martha because of the death of their brother Lazarus. And as they're making preparations, the disciples suddenly realize, hey, we're going back into Judea, back into that region where the leaders are out for Jesus' blood. And they begin to be fearful. But it's Thomas that speaks up and shows his commitment and his courage and his willingness to follow Jesus wherever Jesus goes. He says, let us rise and go with him that we may also die with him. That doesn't sound like a doubt to me, does it? It sounds like somebody's great faith. The next time we encounter Thomas is in the upper room on Monday Thursday. You notice that powerful scene as Jesus begins his discourse with his disciples. He tells them, don't let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it weren't so, I'll tell you. And I'm going to go and prepare a place for you. And if I go, I'm going to come back again to receive you unto myself. And then he says this. He says, and you know the way I am going. And it's Thomas that speaks up, I think, and really speaks for all the disciples. When he says, Lord, I don't think I was in class that day. I'm not really sure the way you're going. So we begin to see some questions, a little bit. The next time we hear Thomas is in our text for this morning. And we hear, and I want you to make sure you understand this, the other disciples are gathered together, but Thomas is not with them. We don't know why Thomas is not there. Perhaps he is so overborne by his grief that he just can't stand to be around the other disciples. He has to go off and grieve by himself. You ever had that experience? Where you've been so overwrought by grief, you just really can't even be with somebody else. You have to have that time to grieve for yourself. Maybe that's why he's not there. Maybe he's gone off to try to start his life all over again now that Jesus is gone. We're not sure why he's not there, but we know he's not there. And before we want to get on Brother Thomas, let's look at the other disciples. The scriptures tell us they're together, but they are behind locked doors. And they're scared to death. That doesn't sound like they ought to be, does it? I was reading a commentator this week named Scott Hosey, and he posed a very provocative narrative here. He asked this question. He said, why didn't they go looking for Jesus? Now remember, earlier in the day, Mary comes to them and says what? The Lord's out of the tomb. We don't know where his body is. Why in the world didn't they go out to look for Jesus' body? They didn't believe Mary when she came back and said, we've seen, I've seen the Lord. They didn't believe her then. We're told the reason they're behind locked doors is because they're afraid of the authorities coming together. But that doesn't seem likely either. Because earlier in the day, when they heard about the tomb being empty, their fear didn't stop Peter and John from running straight away to ground zero of the situation itself, the empty tomb, where the authorities were probably being the biggest. They went running then. They weren't afraid then. So why are they afraid now? It just doesn't make sense. But this is what Scott says, and I think this is very provocative. What if the reason they're afraid is that they're afraid that they might actually encounter the risen Jesus? What if they're hiding because they're afraid of finding Jesus? I mean, they have deserted him in his hour of need. Maybe he will come back and punish him, right? But more than that, what if Jesus really is alive? What if what he said is really true? What does that mean for the lives of the disciples? Their lives are going to be completely different from that. And all of this is just swirling in their heads. And so what do? They do the thing that makes the most sense to them, and that is that they get behind a door and they lock it, and they're there hiding away from the world, away from themselves, and away from Jesus. Or so they think. But you know, brothers and sisters, the narrative throughout the scriptures, throughout the gospels, is a narrative of a Lord that comes to hunt for us when we're lost, when we're scared, when we're afraid, when we're in hiding. And Jesus does it again. The door's locked, but that's not going to stop Jesus. And he appears in their midst according to the scriptures, and what does he do? He says, peace be with you. This is not a greeting, merely a greeting. This is Jesus saying to them, I want to give you my sense of shalom, my sense of wholeness. Guys, I know you got scared and you ran away. I forgive you. I know you're here not understanding what all this means, and I forgive you. And I want you to be empowered. And he breathes on them according to the text and says, receive the Spirit. This is called the Johannine Pentecost. He's giving them a blessing. He's saying, guys, I know you've been scared. You are forgiven. And more than that, you're empowered. You can go forth from here as a victor. And all of a sudden, these guys who've been scared for their lives, who have been in grief and in doubt, all of a sudden, all that's gone. And they are elated and joyful, and they are empowered. They're not scared anymore. And so when they run into Brother Thomas, they say, Tom, guess what? Jesus is alive. We've seen him. What does Tom say? Ah, you boys, y'all, something wrong with you. Unless I see him myself, unless I experience him myself, I ain't gonna believe. Thomas had trouble believing what seemed to be unbelievable. Now, a lot of people of faith want to point their finger at that and look down on that doubt experience
and they look down on Donald Thomas. But I want you to think about this. Isn't it a fact that doubt is something that affects all of us on some level of our life at one time or another? We're going to point a finger at Thomas now, really? Let's think about this. Doubt is a real problem. And, you know, I think we have to acknowledge this morning that some people, they just absolutely refuse to believe in anything, including the existence of God. Some people are absolutely closed off with that. They're not going to believe anything. Despite the preponderance of evidence of God's existence and of His love and care, it's so obvious to so many of us, a lot of people look at all of that and they'll say, huh, the creation, sunlight, you know, all that's the result of a big bang. Some chance happening. Just everything got together right in it, and that's what happened. They hear our testimony, they hear the witness of the Scriptures, and they think of it as so much hot air. There's an old joke told about a man who's fishing out of Loch Ness. And suddenly his boat came under the attack of Nessie herself. And as the boat is smashed and he is flung into the air, this atheist calls out, "Oh my God, please help me!" And everything freezes. This atheist is suspended in air, and suddenly there's this booming voice from the sky that says, "I thought you said you didn't believe in me." To which the atheist replies, "Come on, God, give me a break. 2 minutes ago, I didn't believe the Loch Ness Monster either." There's an old saying that says this: without faith, no evidence is sufficient. With faith, no evidence is necessary. Without faith, no evidence is sufficient. With faith, no evidence is necessary. Despite the fact that we have all the evidence, there are many who doubt even the existence of God. And so to them, the story of the resurrection is like a Grimm's fairy tale. It's hard for the light of truth to penetrate the shuttered windows of skepticism. So there are some people who are hard-boiled doubters. But there are others who are affected by doubt to varying degrees, just like our brother Thomas. Look at Thomas. He loved God. He followed Jesus very faithfully, as faithfully as some of the other disciples. And he was a disciple of the good news. But when that good news came to its fruition, he just couldn't bring himself to believe in the good news of resurrection. He loved God. He loved Jesus. But remember, he wasn't with the other disciples. He had not had their experience. And so he simply could not believe in Jesus' victory. Some years ago, the Scripps Howard News Service carried a story about a prominent Washington, D.C. lawyer named James Kelly. Mr. Kelly, along with some of the people in his congregation, were devout Episcopalians who refused to believe in the truth of the resurrection. Mr. Kelly was quoted as saying, "We love the stained glass windows. We love the vestments. We love the incense and the liturgy. And all of those things, it's aesthetics, it's drama. And we don't believe we ought to have to give all that up just because we don't believe in the resurrection." Whether it's in a liturgical setting or in a modern contemporary church, brothers and sisters, there are a lot of folks today, even in houses of worship, who have a rudimentary understanding of God and Jesus, who love the pageantry and the music of the church. And as long as they're being entertained, as long as their whims are being catered to, as long as the church is holding up some societal standard of morals, then it's wonderful. But they fail to understand that we do what we do not for entertainment purposes and not for appeasement purposes. And we're not doing it to prop up a bunch of preconceived notions that people have. We do what we do because we have been empowered by and called by the resurrected Lord. That's why we do what we do. Some people just can't wrap their heads around it. And so they have a hard time believing. So how do we believe the unbeliever? I point to my friend, Brother Tom. He shows us how to believe the unbeliever. You see, doubt disappears when we meet the risen Lord for ourselves. Doubt disappears when we meet Him ourselves. In John's Gospel, the word believe you was there. The disciples got to see Jesus. Thomas did not. He had not had that experience of seeing and being in the presence of the resurrected Christ. The scriptures tell us 8 days after this, they're together again. This time Thomas with them, and what happens? Jesus appeared, doesn't he? And he tells Thomas, come on over here, look at the scars, see them, touch them for yourself, and know that this is real. Now, interestingly enough, did you notice what we didn't hear in the witness, the scriptures? We didn't hear whether or not Thomas actually reached over to touch Jesus. We don't know that he did that. He may not even touch Jesus. But you know what it does record? It records one of the most powerful confessions of faith in all of the scriptures. When Thomas declared very simply, my Lord and my God. You notice in verse 29, it sounds like Jesus is sort of rebuking Thomas a little bit. It sounds like he's saying, well, you believe God you saw, but there's going to be other folks that won't be able to see, and they're going to believe, and they're going to be blessed. That's not a rebuke of Thomas. That's a blessing that you admit. That's Jesus saying, Tom, you've been able to see, and now you believe. That's wonderful. And guess what? Because you've been able to see this evening, you're going to go out and proclaim the word. And through that proclamation, people who won't get this chance are going to be able to believe as well, and they're going to be blessed too. Thomas couldn't bring himself to believe until he was in the presence of the risen Lord himself. When he had a chance to be in relationship with the risen Lord. And when that happened, he was able to believe the unbelievable. The Reverend Jerry Cook talks about a time when he went to visit one of his members who was getting ready to have some really risky open heart surgery. A surgery that Jerry himself had had a few years before. They were talking back and forth, and finally this man looked at Jerry and said, Jerry, I want to ask a favor of you. It's going to sound strange, but I'd like to ask a favor of you. And Jerry said, sure, what do you want? He said, can I see your scars? Jerry said, sure, I'll be glad to show them to you. Unbuttoned his shirt and showed the place where the surgery had gone through the sternum to get to the heart. He lifted his pants leg up and showed where they had done the grafting work to get the vein out to put into the heart. The man looked at those scars and he sat back and with tears in his eyes and said to Jerry, thank you. Now I have hope. Now I have hope. You see, being able to see Jerry's scars gave this man the hope that life, after this life-threatening surgery, was going to be a real possibility. In much the same way, when Thomas was able to see the scars of our Master, it gave him the blessed assurance of knowing that we're not created just to be here in one instance and then blink into non-existence out there somewhere. It showed Thomas that we have been created to serve and love God, to be saved by Him for life, abundant here and now, and eternally to come. That assurance gave Thomas the strength to cast fear and doubt aside, and enabled him to go forth as an apostle of grace to the country of India. Talk about the rest of the story. Let me show you that. Did you know that? He went to India. And he established many churches in India. And in A.D. 72, he was killed with a lance because he refused to surrender his unshakable faith in the resurrected Christ and in the good news of salvation. How does that sound for that? You and I may not have the blessed opportunity to see those physical scars for ourselves, but guess what? Our risen Lord, through the power of the Holy Spirit and the testimony of faithful witnesses that have come before us, has enabled us to meet Him for ourselves. In a way we really can't fully explain, He shows us His star that won for us the victory of life, abundant and eternal. Even as He empowers and fits us for standing firm for the good news of resurrection and salvation. He enables us to see for ourselves so that we might believe as we come into a saving relationship. Brothers and sisters, I give thanks to God for the example of all of the disciples in our text for today, especially example, Thomas. Because they show us that the Easter message is more than just a pleasant story. It is a powerful truth with powerful implications for our lives and for the world. What does it mean for you and I this morning to say He is risen indeed? What does it mean for us to live as God's Easter people in the midst of a culture that is increasingly hostile to God and to God's people and to the message of God, calling it Christian privilege? Something we ought to be ashamed of and have. We're privileged because we're Christian. We're not ashamed of it. What does it mean for us to live in that kind of world? The temptation, I think, sometimes is for us to look at the example of the disciples early in the text. To hide ourselves behind the doors. To keep the good news to ourselves. And to deny that nothing will ever change. Now, this is never going to change. David Bartlett once said, you know, we in the church will sing, "A mighty fortress is our God." But the truth of the matter is, what we mean is, a mighty fortress is our church. We may think we can hide, but we've got a master who will come looking for us, and He will find us. And that's good news, because when He finds us, He gives us forgiveness for those times when we failed Him. He shows us His scars that won victory in life for us. And He empowers us to go out and stand for Him in the midst of an unbelieving world. Have you come this morning for that good news? Because you understand, it's really up to us whether or not we're going to believe that this good news is just some hallucination, or if in fact we are going to choose by the grace of God to believe with all of our hearts and with all of our lives that which the world says is unbelief. It's up to you. Open shoes. Thanks to you. Amen. This morning we invite you to turn in your hymnals to page 12 as we continue in our service of Holy Communion. As United Methodists, we believe this is the table of the Lord. It's not our right or our desire to turn anyone away from this table. And though none of us are truly worthy of our own merits even to gather the crumbs from beneath the table, the privilege of coming to this table as a child of the King was bought for us at great price. So at the appropriate time, you come as you feel led of God's Holy Spirit. What's required of us is to have a humble and a repentant heart and a desire to give ourselves over to the truth of the resurrection and its good news and implications for our life and for the world. So at the appropriate time, you come as you the method we use here is invitation. We'll have a couple of stations here at the front. You'll be given a piece of bread. You'll be invited to dip that in the chalice and receive communion, after which you may kneel at the altar for a time of prayer, and you may return to your seats. We also remind you that you may leave an offering for the Barnabas Fund here, the fund that we use to help people who come to us for help. And you may leave that here at the altar elsewhere. Invite you now to turn to page 12 here. Christ our Lord invites to His table all who love Him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another.
Merciful God, we confess and give our conduct with our heart.
We have failed to be an obedient church.
We have not done your will.
We have broken your law.
We have rebelled against your love.
We have not heard our neighbors,
and we have not heard the cry of the needy.
Forgive us. from slavery to synagogue, and made with us a new covenant by the water and the Spirit. On the night in which our Lord gave himself up for us, he took a piece of bread at the table, he gave thanks to God, he broke the bread, he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, he gave thanks to God, he gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is alive.
Christ is risen.
Christ will come again.
Lord, we ask that you pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and all these gifts of bread and wine, make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, that is one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and in peace in his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory to yours, Almighty God, now and forever.
Amen.
And now with confidence of children of God, let's pray together the prayer our Lord taught us. Say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power,
ready, we'll ask the choir question first.
Thank you.
hear so much as that.
Let us join now together in the prayer following communion that you find in your bulletins. Let us pray together. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Our hymn of going forth is hymn number 304 in your hymnals. Easter people, raise your voices.
Give thanks for the great honor and privilege of serving as your pastor. I have been richly blessed by God and by you as we have shared this season of ministry. Thank you for your support, partnership, and love. As a United Methodist pastor,
I am committed to our connectional life in Christ and to servant leadership where I am appointed. In June, I will move to a new appointment and become the pastor of First United Methodist Church in Havelock. Thank you for your prayers as Susie and I and all of us enter this time of transition.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, we give thanks for the gift of life together in your church. Through the Holy Spirit, you call women and men into the ministry of your church. We thank you for our brother and pastor, Reverend Jim Pagan, and for his co-laborer, our sister, Susie Pagan, and pray for your continued blessings upon their life and the life of their family. We also give you thanks for the Reverend Stephen Bazan, who will soon come to lead us. Prepare him and prepare us, we pray, for this new season of ministry. We offer this prayer in confidence as children of the living God.
Amen.
Amen. Beloved, God bless you. We love you. We want you to have a wonderful week. Until we're together again, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you.
Thank you.